Hello viewers, welcome to our program on immigration and legal affairs. I am your immigration attorney Michael Fulwani, and once again we have with us attorney David Nachman. Mr. Nachman, welcome.
Thank you, Michael.
It's Thanks a very me. Interesting program today. We just want to tell you there are two ways people can get a green card. When we say visa processing, that means that applicant has to apply for at an American consulate abroad outside of the U.S. because the consulates are only outside of the U.S. Or if the person is physically present in the U.S., he can apply for adjustment of status. Now, those people that are living and working in India, permanently settled there, they just have no option. They have to go to the consulate to get the visa, whether it's a temporary visa or an immigrant visa. But if those people who are in the U.S., most of the time, they have both options. Because if they are here and they are eligible, other issues, a lot of issues are there. In order to apply for adjustment, the person has to be eligible. Not everybody is eligible. And those cases where a person is not eligible has no option but to go for consular processing. Now, there are pros and cons, both in applying here or applying in India, for example. And we want to talk about what are the advantages and disadvantages in choosing one of the two options. Now, first of all, understand that the consular processing, they go very deep, and a lot of issues come up there which may not come up in the adjustment of status. What are the factors that a person looks into? That a neat, clean, good, excellent case, there's no issue about a consular giving him a hard time. He's eligible, he can do here or there for an immigrant visa. For example, the labor certification is approved, the I-140 is approved, and the visa numbers are available. The husband, wife, let's say wife and the children are living in India, he can choose the visa processing, take a flight to India, go for the interview together with the wife and children. The whole family gets the immigrant visa same day, they are quickly back. Adjustment of status for this person, the family is not in India, so they cannot apply for adjustment. He does the adjustment of status, he gets the green card, and then he can apply under the formal to join Provian for visa processing for the family. So these are, like, as I said, the pros and cons. David, you want to mention something else on the pros and cons? What is the advantage of doing here versus there, or there versus here?
Well, one of the things that, Michael, as you know, is required when you consular process is that you have to obtain police certificates. And obtaining police certificates often is not an easy thing to do. It takes some time and dealing with a separate set of authorities where it could take a tremendous amount of time to obtain police certificates. And it also depends upon how many years an individual has resided in other countries as to getting police certificates from other countries. So that's one consideration when you consular process. Another consideration that we always tell our clients when they consular process is that they're not going to have control of the case. If you file for adjustment of status in the United States, you're going to have control of your case, and you're going to be able to do appeals or request for reconsideration.
And the important thing is the legal representation. A lawyer goes with you for the interview. You are comfortable. The lawyer is there, and you can talk to the immigration officer if there's any issues. In the consular process, you are on your own. You cannot. They do not permit attorneys to go with the applicants on consular processing. So that's a level of comfort is there, and advice is there. You are with a lawyer here. He prepares you before going for the interview. Afterwards, there's a problem. He deals with the problem. And we do that also in consular processing, deal with the problem. But it's not the same thing as being here. One more thing I would say. Let us say there are some issues, some problems that the person knows, either here or both places, okay? But he's here. If he files, and there's, let us say, fraud issues there. So the immigration officer will keep the application pending. And if that person is eligible for the waiver, he'll tell him, okay, I'm holding this case, you should apply for a waiver, and if the waiver is approved, then the case is processed. So the person stays here, right? And still he's here with the family. If he's his wife and children living with him, he's here waiting for the decision. And in most cases, the waiver may be granted, and then the person gets the green card here without going back home. Now, let us say if a person chooses, okay, to go home and apply there, first of all, there is going to be a section 9B, as we call, a bar for 10 years. So in addition to the fraud issue coming in, he has got now two waivers to get. One is for the fraud, one is for the bar of 10 years. And it takes a lot of time because that application has to be prepared, that has to be submitted to the American consul. American consul will again interview the person before sending that application to USCIS, the immigration office in New Delhi in most cases. Maybe a year, stuck there, or more, or forever, if that is denied, 6C. Because lifetime bar. Now, in the US, of course, I mean, it's, you can appeal here, and the appeals keep going on and on. Remember in one of our last programs, we talked about a lady from Poland who was keeping the case, fighting for 22 years, and she was able to remain here. Ultimately, she still went back home, but was able to come back in 2 or 3 years. So this is another big advantage. Let me just give you one or two examples, if we have a little time. Let me see. Let us say a person who is in India and applies for a visa. American consuls are looking holes. Is there some misrepresentation? Is there some fraud? Is there some smuggling issues? And then try to take the charge to him, which is a lifetime bar sometimes and very serious charge. In the immigration service, they are not going that deep. Something is on the table very clearly. They say, oh, this is a fraud here, this is a misrepresentation here, and they charge. But they are not like spending a lot of time to dig and find out where they can deny. They are most likely, and I think David will agree with me, most immigration officers want to close the case, interview it, everything, no problem, done, over. There's another line person waiting in the line. As against the consuls. Consul wouldn't mind spending, I see, two hours of interviews and digging, trying to file the holes. Let's give you a recent, case that came to my attention. Now, people think that once you are a US citizen, nothing can happen. Here is a person who is a US citizen, he filed for his parent. It was a simple, straight case. There's generally no problem. Petition is approved, the father goes for interview, and the consul started asking the question. How did your son go to US? And he's already a citizen. Come on, you know, we're going digging the, you know, beyond his whole history. Of course, unfortunately, he came without a visa, border crossing, and then he was able to get the green card because he was a 245i, okay, labor certification was filed in time and all that. But here the question goes, how did he go to US? He said, without visa. He's an honest person, you know. I said, well, how did he go to without a visa? There was an agent who helped him, but you must have helped. Didn't you hear your son? Did you help him? Did he need money? Yeah, that agent wanted $4,000, so I gave him the money. Now, what that does to Khan say, aha, that is smuggling 212A6E, you know, but they could have charged, but they cannot charge to the citizen, okay? But they charge this father with a fraud also, because in a way he did help, in a way 6E also, because he did help that person, although it's an old story. 10-year-old story, he's saying the 6E fraud and smuggling both. So this is terrible. I mean, something like this. Imagine now they are going back to the citizen. Not one, three cases I've already seen. They are grilling the beneficiary applying, and based upon the son or the daughter or wife who went over US without a visa or any other issues that they can somehow charge him with fraud or misrepresentation. I think it's time for a short break. Let us take a break. Very interesting. We tell you a lot about these issues and which will be very, very helpful to you. Please stay tuned. We will be back. Welcome back. Just before the break, we were talking about consular processing versus adjustment of status, and I was telling you some examples, some sad stories. Let us continue with what kind of stories take place during consular processing, and what happens to those people, and what waivers, if any, are possible in those kind of situations. Let's talk about a person who goes and applies for, let's say a lady, actual real case I'm telling you. She was getting married to somebody, a US citizen, but they didn't want to wait for a year of visa processing. She goes and applies for a B1, B2 visa, which was denied, only simply because the consul didn't believe that she was going to come back. At that point, there were no issues. Simply, Section 214B, that the consul was not convinced that she is going to come back. Okay, so after 15 days or 20 days, then she gets married to this US citizen. and then the citizen files a petition for her. Petition is approved, of course, and then the girl goes back for an immigrant visa interview. Consuls look at her previous application, that 15 days before the marriage she came and applied for a B1B visa. Are you kidding? She must, they must have planned this wedding. I mean, wedding was already planned, cards were composed, the cards were already distributed, and she's coming and applying for a B1B2 visa. Remember, there's a question in the application form also. Do you have any of the following relatives, husband, wife, father, mother, fiancé or a fiancé? So they say, 15 days before, you had plans to get married to the citizen, were you engaged? In your form, you said no fiancé, fiancé. That is a fraud. Section 6C, a lifetime bar. I mean, these things happen. People don't realize. They say, okay, you didn't give us a visa, so what? I'm going to apply for a green card now. Get married to him. You are planning to get married anyway. So that's bad. Let me tell you a worst case, and then I'm going to be able to make some comments. This person married in India. He gave a paper divorce to the wife, a typical case all the time. And he comes to US without a visa, he gets married to a US citizen, he gets a green card, so somehow good luck to him. Then he becomes a US citizen, because somebody told him, don't apply for your real wife until you become a citizen, so he waits until become a citizen. Then he goes to India and remarries his own wife, not showing that she is a former wife, because in application for the green card, he never mentioned that he was previously married, even if there was some mutual divorce or something. So he files a petition for her. They already have one or two children born before he even came to US. So the consul, and then what they do, the tricky way they do it, that they don't show that this was the former wife, somebody else's widow, or she was previously married with somebody else and that person divorced her. So they think that's okay, now what the consul going to do? Can I not marry a widow? Can I not marry a divorced person? Consul, not that stupid. Consul see this because they have a lot of experience. Every day they see where the fraud comes from, what people do. Consul says, okay, I want to do a DNA test for the father and the children and you know. Now obviously the DNA test will show it is his daughter, not a previous husband or previous anything. So they come then to say, now what do I do? I say, you got a problem, my friend. Now the consul is going to charge you with a fraud. Also, then basically the wife is going to be denied. They deny to the wife that this is not a bona fide situation because your husband did not have a bona fide green card or bona fide citizenship. So then they are denied. But in some cases, they also send the file back to the immigration service with this complete history and story and all that. And it is possible, I mean, I've seen some cases, nothing happens other than the denial. And denaturalization, they make a decision on case-by-case basis. But it can come and haunt even a U.S. citizen's son, because for the past story that he committed a serious fraud. And the marriage or divorce itself was not valid, and the marriage, the citizen was not valid, he get a divorce, and again commits a fraud by showing that wife was somebody else's wife once upon a time. What do you say?
Well, I just wanted to actually go back, Michael, to the advantages and obviously the cases that you're mentioning and the questions emanate from the question of whether or not it's beneficial to consular process versus adjustment of status.
Yes.
And one of the often overlooked advantages of doing the adjustment of status in the United States is the ability to utilize Section 106C. Section 106C under the American Competitiveness in the 21st Century Act allows an individual who has an approved labor certification, an approved I-140, and after you file the adjustment of status, after 180 days, they actually get a property right, if you will, that's the way it's described, in the labor certification process, and can move to another job in the same or similar occupation. If you consular process, you give up that opportunity to use Section 106C. So that's also something that an individual needs to look at if they want to decide between adjustment of status versus consular processing.
Let me go to the another story. Family, fourth preference, brothers and sisters of U.S. citizen. A brother who's a U.S. citizen here files a petition for a brother in India, and the petition is approved, and the time comes when the consular processing is going to take place. What this brother, U.S. citizen brother, did when he filed the petition, he added the brother's name, and he put the brother's wife's name, and he put four children's names. Actually, there were only three of his own. One was maybe another sister's son, and the family pressure came in, and he just added. Because they think, how the council is going to, we'll give them the birth certificate, we'll give them all the documents, with the part of the family, the whole family will get it. Councils get a doubt. Councils, I don't know how they do also, they're very smart, they look at the faces, they look at the dates of birth, the difference between, they look at the ages of the children, in many, many different ways. So then, once they have a doubt, they grill the wife that was coming. How many children you have? Tell the truth, this and that. And she says, four is mine, all four are mine, all four are mine. Okay. Then, councils are smart. They ask the other three children about the fourth one. Is that, Rohit, also your own child, your brother or sister? Yes. Because they were told, the council has say yes, say yes, say yes. Everybody says yes. Then council conducts a field investigation or do a DNA test again. Okay, let us have this children, all the DNA tests. And then, of course, DNA test, they find that he's not the child. So then what happens, he denies the whole family. He puts a fraud charge, plus he puts a smuggling charge against the wife and against all the three children, because they all participated in the scheme. They consider that people don't think smuggling. They think smuggling means you put the child or somebody in the trunk of the car and cross the border. If you assist, help, in whichever way to help a person get an immigrant visa or a green card, which is not, for which he is not eligible, because this child, fourth one, was not eligible, that is considered a smuggling charge. So this is a serious thing, because in the 6C, a waiver is available only if you are trying to smuggle your own child in a way, changing the date of the birth or something like that, that is still waiverable. But if you are trying to smuggle a child who is not of your own, there is no waiver available on that.
Right.
Okay. So basically, some of these are issues that are very, very serious. When people come and talk to us, talk to you, we say, why did you do it? Why did you do it? And they say, the travel agent told me, or some family friend told me, and we keep on saying, that's what happens when you do not go to a good lawyer and good advice before doing something. Sometime the patient is already dead, he has been buried in the grave, and you are telling to dig it up and then put a life into that, things may not be possible. I think it's time for a short break. I know you like these stories and you are learning a lot from this. We will be back and we continue to tell some more examples of fraud and misrepresentation and the problems in visa processing. So stay tuned, we will be back. We were telling you some interesting stories where people go for a visa processing and they get stuck with the charges of fraud, misrepresentation, smuggling. Let me tell you one of the other stories, very, very common. A lot of people are doing these days and have done it. Here the US citizen who wants to get married in India. And he was told that the entire processing will take about a year or 14 months. And he can't wait for his wife for 14 months. He loves her so much. Every day is a problem. David is smiling, he understands. What is the separation with a wife or a child?
Could never happen in 14 months.
Okay, so idea is given to him again by some unethical lawyer or some travel agent or a friend that, listen, the best way is that you file a K-1 fiancé petition for your marriage is still over about a year to happen. 1 year in advance you start this process. This K-1 will be approved and the council will issue the K-1 visa. You quietly go there whenever you go get married and then don't apply for immigrant visa at that time in India. She has a valid K-1 in the hand and she can travel back to US on K-1. And when you come to the US, then you get married within 90 days as the rule is. And then you apply for adjustment of status in the US. Good planning? I don't know. It goes wrong, then what happens? Because counselors are very, very smart. When you go for the interview, the wife goes for the interview, they want to know. First question is, show me the pictures of a ceremony. That is, in Hindus, for example, they go around the fire 7 times. We call it Satpapadi. And the pictures don't have that. and then the counsel goes more. Once he sees, he's very smart. Once he does not see, he thinks there's something wrong here. And then he comes to know that this girl has, the K-1 visit petition pending. I'm sorry, this is a different situation. Where I-130 wasn't there, this girl had a K-1 petition approved, but she applied for a K-1 visa to come with the husband on a K-1, quietly, not saying anything about the marriage that took place in India. So the consul grills, and he does an investigation, and he found out that they just got married, because when they go to the neighbors and the people, they say, oh yeah, we just had last month, there was a party, and they have an invitation card also with them. They show the pictures, consul has all the evidence, and then he charges that girl with a fraud lifetime bar, seriously. Of course, in some cases, we are able to get a waiver of that, and the consuls are a little bit more lenient because the marriage is real, they know that. It's the technicality, just jumping the line and trying to get something, like this. So again, it's a very, very bad situation. So what? Get married, come and file a petition in 14 months, 12 months, whatever it is, deal with it, talk to her every day on the phone, you have Skype, right, these days you can look at her and she can look at you, pass the 1 year somehow, and later come on an immigrant visa. Now, one reason to do that also is that, remember, when right now the difference is also reducing between the K-1 visa and I-130 approvals, so you're really not going to save much time, maybe 2-4 months. But it's not a good idea to go through a situation where there could be a serious problem with the fraud. So that is not a good idea, and I would say again, go the strict legal way and do it what is right.
Always handling it the right way is best. The information, of course, getting that disclosure from your client is what's difficult.
Yeah, basically, counsels say, the people say, well, how would he know, a recent case, how would we know, how would the counsel know about this and that? This is a case where this girl was here, illegal, married to a US citizen, and then she could not adjust because there's no 245i, right? So somebody says, oh, you send the girl back to India, she can stay there. She says, I never been to US at all. Husband filed I-130 petition like that, no mention about her ever coming to US, okay? Petition got approved, of course. Consul just wants to see the marriage certificate, because what he did, she did not marry in the US, actually, going back. She went to India, then he went there, and he got married there, so there was a proper marriage certificate, proper photos, and everything else. So that part was okay. Okay, he did the right thing in terms of filing a petition after the real marriage. But he lied on the fact that she was ever in the US, and she was staying 2-3 years in the US illegally. Now, they don't know. Same thing. But how would the consul know? I mean, I'll say that I met this girl in India first time, and I got married, and consul know. How did it know? Because in this case and many other cases, there is a poison pain letter. I'm told that from Gujarat itself in India, Bombay consulates get at least 15 to 20 letters every day, which is why you call the poison pain letters. A relative or a former girl, boyfriend of the girl, anybody that doesn't want that marriage, is not happy with it, he's got a problem, animosity between the families, whatever. The consul had a letter, details about when she went, where she stayed. He even had 2 or 3 pictures, I don't know where he got from, in the US with that girl, going with this boy, moving around. So they said, come on, you're lying. So they denied her the visa, and the serious problem comes in. Now, not only denied, they charged it with fraud, they charged it with 10-year bar because she had stayed. Now this person has to go through a waiver process and put in a lot of documents, information. It's going to take much time to get even the waiver approved, and if unfortunately the waiver doesn't get approved, it's a lifetime bar. This citizen will have 2 options, either to divorce her, start her life somewhere again, or go back and settle back in India with her. Very serious decisions, very serious things. What did he try to do? Save a few months of coming earlier, that's all was it. Or in this case, sorry, he could have stayed. The girl could have stayed, she was staying in a few more years, 2-3 years, 4 years, and somewhere in the line, there might have been a change in the law some way that she could adjust or whatever.
It's the value of having good information and planning appropriately.
Yeah, or even if she was ready for the fraud, they could have married here and she would have gone. There will be no fraud charge. There will only be an unlawful presence charge, which is easier waiver than a fraud and unlawful presence both, and not having sufficient reasons for getting a proper waiver. So this basically, a lot of people don't understand that there is, like in Mumbai I know, there's an anti-fraud unit, and there are, I think, 2 officers, and there are 3 or 4 Indian staff. They go to those even small towns and do the investigations. They go and knock the doors of the neighbors and ask them, do you know this person? Is he single or married? And he had applied as a single, and they say, oh yeah, he's married, his wife is here, right there, in the house. So they don't understand that the consular officers these days go through deep interviews, they find out about these issues, they do field investigations. They are doing on the phone also, in your employment cases, for example. At the night time, the consuls pick a phone and call the employer in the US. If this person is coming to you, H-1 case. If this person coming to you on an H-1 visa, he doesn't know anything, because he only deals with the...
What are the responsibilities that the individual is going to have?
I have no idea at all. We don't even have any contract with the company that you are saying. And then the consul knows that there's some fraud in this, and the petition is written back to immigration for revocation. And in some cases, there could be a fraud or misrepresentation charge as well.
Well, oftentimes the consulate officials never reach the right person and gets why they get the wrong information.
But they also pretend that an insurance company calling about your husband, we want to know.
Yeah.
And now he has applied as single, but they know, they say, oh, my husband is out of town, he's not at work. And then they get all the information, they laugh and they say, the wife, we talk to the wife and she comes from. So a loan officer will call for a loan application that your husband made and things like that.
Interesting way to do an investigation.
Interesting way to do. So be careful. Don't underestimate the consular abilities to do these field investigation and charge your family members or you with a fraud, misrepresentation, 10 years bar and a lifetime bar or smuggling charges. I think it's time now. We have come to the end of the program. And we hope you find these stories, these information. They are real stories. They are not just made up things. This happens every day that we see happening at the American consulates abroad. And be careful and try to avoid doing any fraud, misrepresentation. End of the day, it's not a good thing to do. And if you have questions, consult a good experienced immigration attorney that he can take you to the right path, give you the right advice. David, you join me in that?
I join you in that. I absolutely agree.
Okay.
There's doing fraud is penny wise and pound foolish. Right?
Thank you very much, David, coming on the program. And guys, thank you very much, Michael, for watching the program.
Keep
watching us every Saturday at 1 p.m. only on TV Asia. Thank you.
We're writing your questions to us.